doing well, thank you. Yourself?
Hello, and welcome to VS Church Europe. Today, we're gonna discuss Matthew 3.
Maybe our human self would be more
and enjoy the night. Today.
Fill him with your love, and that this love he
pre-service talking a little bit. Hello.
Okay. Yeah. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Good evening.
Amen.
Cool. From Europe.
Amen.
Oh, it's 10 a.m. Where's yours?
Ah.
Hello.
Hello.
Well, let me get slides up. Or slides. Someone already has slides.
Yeah. Yay!
Someone
did. Hello, Joris. What is
Go with the countdown, Joris.
Go with the countdown, Joris.
Go with the countdown, Joris.
Are you hosting L today?
I am hosting, young sir. Yes.
Yeah. Oh, good.
Momento. What, bro?
And,
I don't think this is tough.
Yeah,
I can't believe it's 10 a.m. Let me get this. This is going to be a big distraction. One moment, James. Let me get a hug here, but I got to get my hands back. I'm missing hands. Un momento.
I'm in 2D today, so I can't wave. But...
Tingling.
Okay.
Hello.
There we go.
Get the pictures then.
Mind-blowing.
Now that we have Alina back to work in order. Good evening.
Guacamole. Hi, James. How are you doing?
I'm doing good. I have today off, so.
Woo-woo. How exciting. How cool is it for you to be able to say that? Oh, yeah, I'm doing really well. It's my day off. Isn't that kind of cool?
Yeah. I just came here to get a hug and then make some guacamole and then do my laundry and then get some mud off my sibling's dog has made.
Yeah, I'm sleeping today. Ooh, Galactics, you have a very, very busy day. Your day off is a day off from money-making work, and it is filled with just everyday living work. Yeah.
Yep.
Welcome to the world of adulthood, man. Every young person wants it, but once you get there, you're like, work.
Here,
Galactic.
Hi.
How are you doing today?
Good evening from the Europe.
I know. I try and add my in front of it. My morning. Good morning. Ooh, I've shared portal. With Pastor Soto.
I don't
and
see the
I think we're gonna try and get in there and play together, all of us. So next time, of course, we're able, we're gonna reach out. Yeah, have a good day. I love you, sweetie. We'll talk as soon as we can.
Sonic.
Oh, good. How are you feeling? You feeling okay?
Yeah. Just a minute.
Everything is going well.
First
comes
race.
Fantastic.
Oh, yeah.
Yay!
Yeah,
Randy.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to Virtual Reality Church. My name is Alina, and I'm a pastor here at Virtual Reality Church. And behind me here, we have our church family from all over the globe. And everyone is welcome at Virtual Reality Church. It doesn't matter if you believe in God or not. So grab a headset and download all
the
VR chat. And come experience
doing good.
Something that you have never experienced before.
Hey, how are you?
Yes, awesome. Thank you. Welcome, guys, to VR Church. And my name's El. You can just call me El. It's all good.
Sorry. Let me do this. I'm gonna mute. Oh, yeah. There we go. Got it. And El, I'm very sorry, but I accidentally muted you. Did you unmute yourself?
Okay, there we go. Sorry about that. I was muted by accident. Yeah, no worries. I'm on air now. Yeah. Guys, can you all hear me? Can I get some heart emojis if you can hear me? Coolio. Right, I'm going to start again because I was muted. Whoops. Sorry about that. Right, so welcome to VR Church. My name's El. I'm going to open with prayer today. So I'm just going to say, Lord, thank you so much for your provision. Thank you for the example you set for us, that when you stepped forward into the lowliest place, that is to wash the feet of the disciples, you showed us that we must humble ourselves in order to be exalted by you. You stepped down and you washed the disciples' feet. And in doing so, you just showed us such a serving heart and that we must serve each other. And in serving each other, we love each other. And that's what it's all about. The love as one of the main commandments is to love thy neighbor. And that is such a glorious way of showing that love, Lord. So today, let us know that we serve each other. I am serving you. We are all serving each other. And to just to be such a loving spirit to each other. Lord Jesus, we thank you. We honor you. We praise you. Amen.
Amen.
Okie dokie, next slide, please. We have some worship music. Nice. Very nice. Thank you. Thank you, Yoris. Coolio. Right. So I was thinking about this today, actually, about good works. And oopsie, I've just jumped a mile. Hang on a second. I was thinking about good works. And I was thinking, you know, like sometimes when we have people in filtering, I'm not sure what country you come from. I'm sure most countries have got filtering. You have one person goes in, one person goes out. Now, myself, I'm gonna be honest here. I've been quite naughty on the road sometimes. You know, in the past, I'm not anymore. I'm really good at it now. But you know, a good work can be just letting that person in that's pushing in front of you. You know, because you don't know what impact that's going to have on that person in that time. It could make their day for them, and the opposite could be the straw that breaks the camel's back, as Alina said earlier. So, a good work, in my opinion, is something that we can just let someone have that last pasty on the road because they're hungry. You know, that to me is a really good work and something to be thinking of, and that's something that we at VR Church are having a focus on for this season. So, you know, think of it, guys, just the tiniest little thing we are going to be judged on one day. And if we are going to be judged on our good works, then make all that we do a good work for someone, because you never know the impact you're going to have on someone. Can I have the next slide, please, Yoris? Thank you. And on that one, everyone, absolutely everyone is welcome at VR Church, guys, no matter what religion you are, no matter what you believe, no matter what it just doesn't matter. Absolutely doesn't matter where you come from or whatever. You're always welcome at VR Church, and we love you all, and we all want you, and we want you here. So just gonna make sure, there we go, so that the other room can now hear me as well. So our vision for this season is to cultivate loving spiritual communities across the metaverse, and that's just beautiful. You know, that's exactly what you told us to do. It's to love thy neighbor like themselves. And that doesn't matter what community we're in within the metaverse. Let's all be one brotherhood, one sisterhood under Jesus in this metaverse, in this physical universe, and in this virtual world as well. Can I have the next one, please, Yoris? So if you want to get connected, I don't know if you are already connected, we have a Discord server. You can find that on www.mmochurch and www.vrchurch.org. On there will be a link to the Discord server, which means that you can connect on the Discord server so that you can start to become part of our community. Also on those two websites is all the information you need about our church. Next one, please, buddy. And we've got another worship song coming up. Hooray.
Breathe deep. Every breath I take is from you. Hope is running through my veins. Filling up my heart with joy. Love is resurrecting me. You're
Well, that's lovely. So now I'd like to hand over to the absolutely amazing Pastor Alina. Woo! Because of some heart emojis and some clapses.
Oh, thank you so much. Oh, thank you very, very much. Hey, everybody, welcome. I'd like to just give my welcome to everyone here at VR Church. Those of you that are joining us on Twitch or following on YouTube. Hello there, Chris. Welcome. Bagu, welcome. I am coming actually from the overflow room. And if I could have one moderator join me here. We can't have everybody because then we'll have nobody in that first room. But I was just thought I would start here because so often, you know, at the end of service, we stay separated. The group that's in the second room chit-chats, gets to know each other, and the group in the first room does the same. And the pastor is usually always in the first room. And I thought, that makes the overflow room like this, I don't know, like this overflow room, this second room. And I just feel it's very important to make sure that everyone, no matter what room you are in, we are all here together. And we are, you guys are just as important in the overflow room as anybody in any other room. And so I am coming to you from the overflow room. Hopefully everybody can hear me in that main room. If so, if you can just give me some hearts and claps so I know this is working right. Fantastic. Thank you so very much. So yes, let's jump in. Matthew, we're going through the book of Matthew. If you're new here, and you haven't gone, you know, read through the book of Matthew yourself before, you might be a little bit behind. We're in Matthew 3. Here at VR Church, the way we do our sermons is we're just like reading through. There might be even another slide or maybe not, might end here, showing all of the Bible that we've gone through so far, because we go through book by book, chapter by chapter, verse by verse, together, which I think is awesome. So if you're new here and you haven't read through Matthew, really encourage you after you leave here today to catch up and go back and read through Matthew 1 and 2, and or catch up via one of the YouTube videos we have of the previous sermons here at VR Church in Matthew 1 and Matthew 2. And so let's just get started. There is not enough time to share everything I would love to share here in Matthew 3. It is awesome because it is very short, very few verses, but more in these few verses than we can begin to touch on. We're going to be heading up this hill, and actually we're going to have this super fun jump down a waterfall. But for those that are like, I don't like super fun jumps down waterfalls, you can go ahead and take this lower path. Just walk over to the sand and over to the river, and we will meet you there. You're not going to be missing out on anything, of course, other than the super fun jump. And for the rest of you, come on through Matthew 3. Thank you so much, Alice, for this amazing opportunity. Another super fun jump, and here we go into the river. I'm sorry, but it's fun. I got it. I just love it. So you'll see up here, Matthew episode 3. You're like, episode? Is that in the Bible? Episodes? That doesn't make any sense. Well, that's because just as I was sharing a little bit ago about the importance of reading scripture in its entirety, to fully understand it, we can't just like pluck out this and that and, you know, make our decisions on what, how we understand it and what we believe, just based on snippets of the Bible. That is why we go through by book, by verse, chapter by chapter, because we don't want you to miss any of it. It's all so important. It's all tied together, and collectively, this is what helps you to fully understand it. And so episode 3, this is Pastor Soto. He just loves to do this, and I get why, and that's why, because it just shows, you know, if you your favorite show, if you came in season 3 episode 10, you're not going to understand every aspect of this show. It's just not going to happen. You can't, because you missed out on the previous season, previous episodes. And anywho, that is the purpose of Matthew and us adding episode 3. So as we begin, I'll get us started, but In just a moment, I will be asking your help. So we're going to go ahead and allow hand raises. So as we go through the scripture, if you are wanting and willing to help us out today by reading some of this scripture, just raise your hand via the raise hand button on the lower right-hand side, not via the emoji wheel over here, but the lower right-hand side, raise hand, and we're calling on you. Yeah, not that emoji. Super funny. Don't do that. Everybody's doing it now. That's awesome. So yes, we'll call on you and have you help us read. But I'll get us started here. While they were living in Nazareth, and so we are talking about Jesus, his family. While they were living in Nazareth, John the Baptist began preaching out in the Judean wilderness. Again, like I said, if you miss episode or chapter 1 and 2, you've missed the story about how Jesus ended up in Nazareth. And we don't have time to go through the whole thing today, but that's why. Catch up, please, if you can. All right. While they were living in Nazareth, John the Baptist began preaching out in the Judean wilderness. His constant theme was turn from your sins, turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is coming soon. If you were here in this moment, in this time, this is an amazing, wow, time to live. This is where this life-changing transition is about to occur, from living by the law, the laws of Moses, by living by the Torah, these lists of do's and don'ts, and then if you don't or do the thing that you're not supposed to or supposed to do, then these are the instructions for how to go about it. And there's not this direct connection. You're just like, oh God, please forgive me. Help me to not do this anymore. That wasn't the way things were. It was bring this to a priest, to the temple, and there's these offerings, and then the priest goes to God. And so there's a separation between the people and God and living by the law in this Old Testament. Jesus is just about to, he's living now, and he's just about to die, buried, and rise again. His sacrifice for us is just about to happen this time, and it is life-changing. And so this thing, turn from your sins, turn to God. This is different. It used to be turn. Well, not even, you know, it doesn't even instruct you to turn. It does instruct you to not sin. But what I'm saying is it doesn't instruct you to then turn to God. Via the old covenant instructs you to bring these things to the priest, who will then do the thing, and then to God. But this is saying this is new. And that's what I'm trying to share. This is new. All of this is new. It's mind-blowing. It's shocking. We're talking about the Jewish people who have been living by a very strict and detailed way for so long that this idea that from turning to your sins to actually turning to God is rather new. So it's kind of crazy. And this turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is coming soon. This too, you may be asking, what do you mean it's coming soon? This was written a gazillion years ago, and here we are still on earth and, you know, hanging out in virtual reality, and such a long time. How could this be? Well, twofold. God's time is not dependent on the rotation of the earth and its rotation around the sun. God is so much more than that, and his time is different. But also, this is talking about Jesus. This is talking about God being with us. This is talking about we're no longer bystanders. We are going to help share the kingdom of heaven right here, right now. And you don't have to wait till you die, and you don't have to wait till Jesus returns. That there is so much to receive and so much to give right here, right now. And we're going to touch on that a bit more as we continue. So if you follow me into the wilderness. Thank you, Lupus Warrior, for this awesome wilderness. And I'm going to go ahead and start calling some volunteers to help us read. All right. So, Simon, you should be on air. And if you could please read three for me.
Isaiah the prophet had told about John's ministry centuries before he had written. I hear a shout from the wilderness. Prepare a road for the Lord. Straighten out the path where he will walk.
Thank you so much, Simon. Thank you. Yes. There's another translation, just like the turn from your sins, turn to God. There's other translations that say repent from your sins, which are, it's also correct, but the word is, sometimes can be misunderstood. As simply ask for forgiveness, and the part about actually turning away from that sin can sometimes be missed in the word repent, because that's what it means to I'm so very sorry, but not continue to do it over and over and over again. You just have to apologize and you're good, right? No, but I'm so sorry, Lord, and turn away from that, not continue that behavior. There's another translation in here where it says, I hear a shout from the wilderness. Instead of prepare a road for the Lord, straighten out the path, it says like clear a road. There's this idea of clearing something because something new and something better is coming. And so this idea of clearing the road, we are talking again to a group of people who have known one way for generations. And as we all know, when we believe, understand, something, when we go through life, sometimes, you know, we'll find out later that, oh, that was untrue. There was a time we thought that you know, the galaxy we live in was it. There was a time we thought that the Earth was the center of the universe and everything else went around us. And then later, you find this new evidence that says, well, that's just not true. And this happens to all of us throughout our life. You know, you, as a child, maybe you believe in Santa Claus. Later, you find out, whoa, that's not true. But if you don't have, if you're the ability to clear your mind, to be open to listening to information that doesn't, that you don't understand the same or agree with, if you can't hear and see new information because it is contrary to what you understand, we would all still believe in Santa Claus. We would all still, you know, believe in many of these things because we couldn't, like, see the evidence around us. The oh my gosh, I forgot I was in VR and I forgot there were children. I'm very sorry about the Santa Claus analogy. I'm sorry. That was my bad. Anywho, let's continue. It's this idea of clearing that something new is coming, and in order to accept it, to see it, to understand it as truth, you've got to clear first your mind from what your feet are ingrained in, and be open to listen to new information. And should that information prove with the evidence to be true, as it is with Jesus, then you will be blessed by this amazing, you know, by our Lord. So I just wanted to touch on that idea that it's important that we always listen to others and not dig in, because in this case, they, you know, miss out on our Lord and Savior. So let's go ahead, Stuntman. All right, we might have to delete the whole thing for YouTube. Thank you, Stuntman. Yeah. Could you please go ahead and read 4 and 5? I'd appreciate it. Thank you.
Sure. I apologize for my birds. They're preaching themselves. Okay, number
no
4.
Worries.
John's clothing was woven from camel's hair, and he wore a leather belt. His food was locusts and wild honey. Did you want me to 5. Continue?
Yes, please. Yeah.
People from Jerusalem and from all over the Jordan Valley, and in fact from every section of Judea, went out to the wilderness to hear him preach.
Thank you so much, Stuntman. And it's so funny because you're apologizing for your bird. I'm like, oh, there is no better. There's no worse. Than what I have just done. Oh, thank you so much, Stuntman, for reading this for us. And it's really funny here in 4, where it talks about him eating locusts. If you were in the Bible study earlier, Columbo, I think was his name. He I love the way you shared that. John eats bugs. So John eats bugs. Thank you, Columbo or Columbus. Yes. So here we go. We're going to continue across the straight path that has been laid out for us. It's actually laid out for the Lord, who in turn has laid this out for us. And back into the river we go. Now we're actually going to be, you're going to think, why is she still going? But there's something really big I want to share, and I don't have the time to stop and touch on these things. So we're going to kind of go a little fast through some things, and I've got to tell you, there's some really, really cool and important things as we go through here. And if you are able tonight at the 7 p.m. service, Pastor Zach is going to be here teaching, and he is just filled with all this knowledge, like historical historian. He's going to have a different sermon for you than what I have for you. All of it true, all of it good. But I encourage you to come if you can to see Pastor Zach, 7 p.m. Eastern, because you might have some questions as we go through here, and he's likely going to answer most of them or a lot of them. So, Realtor Spar, you are on air, and if you can go ahead and read 6. And okay. 7.
Okay. And when they confess their sins, baptize them in the Jordan River. Number 7. But when he saw many Pharisees and Sadducees coming to be baptized, he denounced them. You sons of snakes, he warned, who said that you could escape the coming wrath of God.
Awesome. Thank you so much. That was perfect. Yes, like there's a big question. Where is this? Where did baptisms come from? Are these the first baptisms? And I actually have, I'm going to take off my Pastor Alina hat and put on just my random logical Alina hat. How, you know, we call them baptisms. And there's, to my knowledge, no prior writings of this happening before. So there's other things besides just this that make me think this. But, you know, John the Baptist, who's baptizing. So there's this correlation that the baptisms and John the Baptist, there's a beginning here. And not to mention, John the Baptist is out there telling and teaching that there is something new, there is something better. This is the beginning of something amazing, which leads me to also think that my regular logical Alina hat, probably baptism started here, likely derived from the washing of the hands and the feet of the priests in the temple, likely. But again, Pastor Zach, he's your guy. He'll be back tonight at 7 p.m. and he'll probably have some more information there for him. So I'm going to go ahead and read 8. Before being baptized, prove that you have turned from sin by doing worthy deeds. This is awesome. Don't just say you're a Christian, but be a Christian. Live as a Christian. Before being baptized, prove that you have turned from your sin. So this way that we live. So there's this, I don't know specifically what the Pharisees and Sadducees have done as far as John is concerned to bring up so much anger, but I do know that the Pharisees and Sadducees were extraordinarily knowledgeable about the Torah, about the scriptures. That was their role, like that's what they did. They had a lot of clout.
some of them and politically, all of them spiritually, and they had a lot of power and control over the Jewish people. And so there's this idea, or not idea, there's this truth. You can know, have all of the knowledge in the world, in the universe, everywhere. You can have all the knowledge everywhere. But if you don't have love, you have nothing. You could be the best at this or that, but if you don't have love, you have nothing. You can, the clanging cymbals, there's a scripture in 1 Corinthians, but if you don't have love, you have nothing. So when I read the scripture, I am seeing him saying, yeah, you're super smart and you're very involved in the religious aspect of things. You're doing very good. You're coming to church. You're doing this. You're doing that. BBB. All these things that outwardly may make you look like this, like really good. I'm saying Christian because we no longer live under the laws of Moses. So I'm going to talk about us here. You could do all, you could give all your money to charity, you could do this, you could do that, you could never miss a service. But if you don't have love, you have nothing. And so here he is saying, yeah, you're super smart in scripture, but apparently they don't have love in their hearts. So they're totally missing everything. Don't try to get by as you are, thinking we are safe. For we are Jews, descendants of Abraham. That proves nothing. God can change these stones here into Jews. Again, doesn't matter where you come from, doesn't matter how smart you are, doesn't matter. None of it matters. If you don't have love, you have nothing. Well, if you can please read 10 and 11, I would appreciate it.
Yep. Sorry, I was muted again. And even now, the axe of God's judgment is poised to chop down every unproductive tree. They will be chopped and burned. With water, I baptize those who repent of their sins. But someone else is coming far greater than I am, so great that I am not worthy to carry his shoes. He shall baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. Oh, yeah.
Thank you. Yes. There's something about when you live in the love that you're called to live in. And this, as Elle was sharing earlier, is not just big acts of kindness and goodness. These are the tiny little things that most of us don't even think about every day that accumulate. Are we saying and doing all or as much? I know we're imperfect, so we're not going to do it perfectly, but as much as, are we striving to live in that love? Are we striving for all of our words and actions to be from love? It's just something to ask. Because when it is, when love is your driving force, when you are kind and patient and helpful and understanding, when you're not shoving things down people, I'm right, you're when you're not constantly argumentative, there's these things that we all have, and they're individually really small. But when these become how you live, like you're always arguing or always having to be right, or it can be even worse. Maybe there's something you've passed down from a family, like the way you treat your family. It could be controlling and abusive. There's countless ways that we step outside of that love. Most of us, they're tiny, and then there's a large portion where they're just kind of the medium. Very few of us struggle with killing people. I mean, we just don't. That's definitely stepping out of the love that we're called to live in. Very few of us, are out there robbing banks, unless you are Pastor Soto and myself, and we're in GTA. But outside of that, very few of us are robbing banks. So we this focus on our everyday, the way we live, is so important. And I wanted to stop here and talk about baptisms. And one thing I forgot to do is make myself on air so I can receive messages if they are important. So very sorry about that. Baptisms. Thank you, El, for room two. Awesome. Okay, I might have to blow through these messages just to clear them, and I'm so sorry if I missed it. You can afterwards come up and try and talk to me or send me another message if you're in the other room. I'd really appreciate it. So, baptisms. So John is sitting here saying, with water I baptize those who repent their sins, who turn away from their sins, who don't want to live this way anymore. That's what it's talking about, the way we live. I baptize those who don't want to live this way anymore. I want to turn to God, live his way. So with water, I baptize those who repent of their sins. But someone else is coming far greater than I am, so great that I am not worthy to carry his shoes. He shall baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. Holy Spirit. I would, for most of us, this is rather obvious. The Holy Spirit. If you keep with us, we're gonna get into where the Jesus sends his Holy Spirit first to the disciples, and there is a real power in that, a real power in the Holy Spirit, and in Jesus will baptize us with the Holy Spirit, will give us the Holy Spirit when we want it. When we want to turn from the life that we're living and turn to him, he will baptize us with the Holy Spirit and with fire. And this fire is not like a scary bad thing. This fire is a refining fire where Jesus himself will change us. We're still going to be us. We're going to be the us that he created us to be. And then we have this wonderful lifelong journey of discovering these changes that he's made in us, because it's not like an instant magic trick. It's still a journey. But I'm almost out of time. Baptisms, VR baptisms. I was baptized in virtual reality about somewhere between 3 and 4 years ago here at VR Church. I know there are people that disagree. They think you need to be in a physical space. They think that you need the physical water, like the baptism that John the Baptist was doing, and that is perfectly okay. We don't have to agree with each other. If that is what you feel is needed and important, please do not get baptized in virtual reality. Please do what you feel is needed and important. I believe from scripture. Oh, stuntman, oh, I did see your stuntman. Can you come talk to me? Come use the arrow to come to me after service. I would love to talk to you. I'm in the other room. Or you do it now, actually, in case the doors close, pretty please. Press the arrow to come to where I am in room two. Just my name and the arrow would be awesome. Yay. Okay. So I was baptized here in VR. And this is, I want to talk about. Is how I don't believe it's the water that baptizes me, but I believe that it is Jesus. I believe that it's Jesus who baptizes me with the Holy Spirit and with this beautiful refining fire. And I am just one example of that. Prior to being baptized here in VR Church, I got to tell you, people know me now as this certain person, this shepherd, this loving, this giving person. That was not me. It just was not me prior to coming and prior to my baptism, prior to me making that very serious decision to turn away from my old life and start a new one. With him. Prior to this, I wasn't out robbing banks and killing people, but I was a selfish person. God blessed me with the most amazing husband who has always, for as long as I've known him, lived in that love that we're called to live in. And this idea of submitting, in other scriptures, you'll see this where sometimes people only pull out wives submit to your husbands, and they don't pull out all the rest that shows how we're supposed to submit to one another. And part of submitting is part of love, and that is putting others first. And my husband would always put me first, 100% of the time. And what did I do with it? This is prior to me being baptized here in VR. This is prior to everything that unfolded after. This is prior to me becoming a pastor and standing here today. I would just take advantage of that constantly. I can have my way in all things because my husband just wants me to be happy. So you want to go on this vacation, bobbity blah, but your husband can't go? I say yes without even talking to him because it's okay because he is going to give me my way because he just wants to make me happy. And so thank you, Sonic. So I would continuously take advantage of that. I was horribly, horribly selfish. The way I interacted with other people, I was horribly, horribly selfish. Got to keep an eye on time. Always, always me first. Every day when you come to work, I was a flight attendant. Oh, you wouldn't believe the horrible, you know, good times. Yes, also good times. But if anything, you know, not perfect happened, I'd be the first one to come in and just lay it on everybody. Oh, these shoes, I lost my shoes in whatever city, and now I have to wear the bad shoes, blah, 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 and I, blah, blah, blah. And someone on the other side that I'm talking to maybe has just lost their loved one or something else. Maybe they've lost their home, something major and traumatic has happened. And my blabbering on about my little thing as if it's the biggest thing in the world, without taking into any thought the other person. How is the other person doing? If you know me today, you'll probably hear me say over and over, how are you? How are you? How are you? It's because now, thanks to Jesus, thanks to my turning from my old life and starting a new following him, I care. I love. I want to know, how are you? And this is what baptism is. Baptism is turning away from your old life and starting new. And it's not to be taken lightly. It's not something you do just for fun. I know some people, and also here's another thing, I've already been baptized before, but I was baptized when I was young, when I didn't have any say in it. I honestly don't even remember it. I was baptized now because I wanted to repent, wanted to turn away from my old life, and I wanted to start anew. And so we're out of time, so I've just got to keep going. I encourage you, if you're unsure, baptisms, are you unsure, you really want to make this turn in your life, and again, you don't have to be baptized to make that turn. The reason why we have this public baptism is because there is nothing greater to celebrate, and we want to gather and we want to celebrate this incredible moment in your life where you're turning from the old one and starting anew, where this new life with Jesus Christ, who is going to refine you in the most beautiful ways. And I promise you, look back at the changes that he makes in you. Oh, thank you, God, for making these changes. I can't believe. Oh, it's not a bad thing. It's a good thing. All he does for you is good. So if you're considering, but you're unsure if VR, if somehow God cannot be here with us now, if somehow God cannot make a difference in your life, if you're unsure, I just encourage you to get in. Read scripture. Read scripture. See what it says about it. That's important. Just right here and now, we're talking about two different types of baptism. What you feel is right for you is what you must do. If you feel you must be somewhere physical, then be somewhere physical. If you feel that this is the right thing for you, then, oh, we'd love to baptize you. As we continue, we got to keep going. I wish I had hours. Maybe in the next sermon, I might just like leave out all that front stuff and talk all about this because it's really important. Thank you, Andy. And something that maybe many of you don't know is that, interestingly enough, even if I wanted to be physically baptized, which I didn't want to be physically baptized, because here at VR Church, this is my home. This is my family. These are the people I want to celebrate this monumental shift in my life. But even if I wanted to be baptized in VR, I mean, in the physical space, I couldn't because of my illness. My illness keeps me confined to my home, except for those doctor's appointments that I can't, like, you can't get around. And I know I am not alone. Whether it be like a physical thing that keeps you from being able to move around on your own. Maybe there's social anxieties. Maybe there is, you've had perfect experiences in a physical church before, and this has driven you away. Because, you know, we are a world made of human beings, and sometimes even people from a church can mistreat you. So whatever it is that makes you, draws you here, and there are many, many, many people. I am not alone. Okay, we've got to keep going. Okay, Everett, could you please read 12? And yes, 12. Please. Short, I'm sorry.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes.
You said 12?
Yes, please.
He will separate the chaff from the grain, burning the chaff with never-ending fire and storing away the grain.
Thank you, Everett. All right, Jen X Ba, could you please read 13 and 14?
Then Jesus went from Galilee to the Jordan River to be baptized there by John. John didn't want to do it. "This isn't proper," he said. "I am the one who needs to be baptized by you."
Thank you, Jen. This is awesome. Okay, one more, and then I'll just have a little snippet to say here. Real Thor Spar, if you can go ahead and read 15, please.
But Jesus said, "Please do it, for I must do all that is right." So then John baptized him.
Awesome. Thank you so much. This is really important. This is about the way we live. Jesus is doing this because everything he did in his life, he was an example for us. You know that saying, what would Jesus do? That's really what we need to think. I know some people think, oh, what would Jesus do? No, what would Jesus do? And he wanted to be this example for us. He didn't actually have any sins to turn away from, but he certainly had the human temptations and worry and stress because he's here in this human body with the same of human brain. And so, yeah, he still needs to make this effort to turn away. And most importantly, he's living by an example for us. And this is way more powerful than any words. Anybody could say a bunch of words. Apparently, these Sadducees and Pharisees were saying a bunch of super smart words and probably accurate to the scripture of the Torah. But without love, you have nothing. And so Jesus here is saying it's not as simple as just, you know, telling people. You have to live it. You have to live in that love, because that's what people respond to. If you really want to share Christ with someone, there's like these two ways. You can be very judgmental, very I'm right, you're wrong, stop this, do this. And people have a tendency to withdraw from that. But when you come to them and you share the love of God, this most important aspect of all say and do, their response is to draw nearer. That's what we do. And so Jesus is sitting here doing this, being such a good example for us. Oh, yeah, Sonic. Being such a good example for us. And we are called to do exactly the same. And super fast, here we go. 16 and 17. Oh, thank you, Sonic. Oh, Sonic, if you could read 16, please, that would be wonderful.
Can anyone hear me?
Yeah, sure can. Thank you.
After his baptism, as soon as Jesus came out of the water, the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God coming down in the form of a dove.
Thank you, Sonic.
And a voice
Go ahead.
From heaven said, This is my beloved son, and I am with, and I am wonderfully proud of him. Pleased with him.
No, pleased with him, proud of him. All true. Thank you, Sonic. You did wonderful. Thank you so much. Yes, and again, a voice from heaven said, "This is my beloved son, and I am wonderfully pleased with him." This thing about, you know, when you love someone, you just like my husband, who has been pouring out everything he has to make me happy. When you love someone, you want to please them. It's part of love. And this isn't saying be a pleaser, as in let people trample on you just and do whatever everybody wants. That's not at all what we're talking about here. But we're talking about why we do what we do. Do we do what we do because we have to, because we're in fear of our eternal, the consequences of our in our eternal life? Or do we do what we do or not do what we do because we love God for all he has done for us, all he's doing for us now, everything he will do for us in the future? There is this relationship. Do you love him? And if you love him, you want to please him. And then lastly, because we're, oh my gosh, not only do you want, you know, you do these things or not do these things because you love him and want to please him, but these things that he, this living in the confines of this love is for us because he loves us. There, we love it all because he first loved us. There's this reciprocal thing that my husband and I have just started, because at first it was just my husband and I was taking advantage of it. But with God, it's the same thing. He first loved us. And in turn, we love him because of this. So we want to please him. His yoke is light. What he asks from us is for our best interest and the best interest of those around us. It's not a boo, I can't, you know, become a Christian, I can't go to parties anymore. No, that's not what it's talking about. It's becoming a Christian, being filled with the Holy Spirit, that real power that will help you in life, and being filled and living in the confines of his love. Love God with all of your heart and each other as yourself. And this living is every moment of every day. That's what it means to live, not to go visit it. To live in it. So, L, if you would please close us in prayer. Really appreciate it.
One second. Yes, I can do that. I was just again unmuting myself.
Yes, Lord, thank you
for all that you give us. We thank you that you are working for us today. You're working for us yesterday, and you are working for us tomorrow. Lord, we just love you so much. We know that you gave us your son so that he could be the sacrificial lamb, that his suffering, his blood could be that that sacrifice that cleans us of our sins. Lord, we turn to you today and we say that we are sorry for all that we have done. We ask for your forgiveness, Lord, and just know that through you we can once again come back to the Lord, as it was told earlier, once upon a time in the Old Testament we could only do it through the temple, but Lord, you are the tabernacle, and through you we can once again come back into the presence of the Lord. Your will be done, your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Amen.
Thank you. Yes. Oh my, thank you. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Sorry, apparently I didn't have my megaphone on. Whoops, sorry, Ms. Mick.
No, and I wanted to say something, but also I didn't want to interrupt you. But, so okay. If you didn't,
no, that's all right.
If you didn't hear the prayer.
Oh, I do apologize. I can do another one if you like. Shall I do another one?
Let's do another one. I think that maybe many people, let's do it. You can't pray enough. Yes, let's do it.
We can never ever pray enough to our Lord and Savior.
No, we cannot.
Not at all. So, Lord, we thank you that through your baptism of fire, we can be once again clean, that we can be once again washed from our sins And Lord, in that example I spoke of earlier where you wash the feet of your disciples, what you are saying in this point is that we are already clean. But every day we pick up a little bit of dirt on our feet. And what you showed us in that is that you are there to clean that little bit of dirt that just makes us once again pure so that we can come to you knowing that we are clean and that we cannot be harmed by your absolute wonderful grace, because we are clean and able to step once again into your kingdom. Lord, we thank you and worship you in this. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. And thank you, everybody, for joining us today. Again, if you would like a little more context, like, there's so much in here, so much in here. Encourage you to come back 7 p.m. See Pastor Zach's sermon. And if you can't make that, it'll be posted on YouTube a little later as well. And so you can catch up and hear all of the just really good things that he has to share. So thank you so much, everyone. I'm going to pop myself off of air. I'm in room 2. So if I disappear, I'm very sorry. If I didn't get to say goodbye to you, I'm very sorry. Love you. Give my hugs around. You know I'm a hugger. All right. Bye, everybody. Thank you.
I was just going to say that we can move over to the prayer area if anybody wants personal prayer. We've got the prayer area on top of that little hill over to the over to that side. And what I was going to say, if it's all right with you, Alina, if everyone pops into room 1, I will delete room 2, and then you can all be in the same place, if it's all right.
All right, everyone.
Yep, I'll give it a go. If we all move to room 1, guys, and then we can delete the other one, we'll see how it goes, yeah?
It seems to be offline, but we're going to end the stream here. Good night from Europe, and see you in our NVA chat by Phantom.